Yeah. Uhuru. 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 Can I be heard?
What's that on?
Testing, testing.
Okay.
Uhuru. Now I hear it. Okay. All right. You guys excited? Yeah. Nah. That was weak. All right. We're going to start all over. All right. Uhuru. Is everybody here excited? If you're excited, let me hear you say Uhuru. All right. Welcome, my beautiful African people, to our Black Power on the Rise in St. Pete celebration, hosted by Black Power 96.3 FM and Uhuru Foods and Pies. My name is Alike Ngoma, and I will be your MC for this evening, or this afternoon. Please put your hands together for Black Power 96 station manager, Diakiese Lungisani.
Uhuru. Good afternoon. Uhuru, uhuru, uhuru. My name is Diakiese Lungisani, and I am your station manager for Black Pride 96.3 FM. I'm also a proud member of the African People Socialist Party, and I want to begin first by expressing my profound appreciation for my leadership and the leader of the African nation, Chairman Omali Yeshitela of the African People Socialist Party. I also want to appreciate the leadership of Deputy Chairwoman Ona Zanae Yeshitela, also President of the African People's Education and Defense Fund. Comrades, brothers and sisters, I welcome you to the Black Power on the Rise in St. Pete celebration. Today we have gathered here in Akwaba Hall to recognize the genius of the African poor and working class and those who stand in solidarity with the mission of Black Power 96.3 FM. Because of you, we have successfully raised our radio tower to the height of 70 feet, doubling our coverage area. This is a tremendous victory that belongs to African people, forcibly dispersed all around the world, colonial subjects under the continuous attacks by white ruling class media, their propaganda machines, and their neo-colonial operatives. The raising of our tower is a profound strike against these media apparatus and is indicative of a future that will be shorn of the white ruling class's tools of propaganda. And it is you who has made this happen. We are also joined today by our sister organization, Uhuru Foods and Pies. Since 1981, Uhuru Foods and Pies has been part of building an independent economy for African people. Uhuru Foods and Pies is also part of Black Star Industries, commerce by and between African people worldwide. This November and December, Uhuru Foods and Pies will be baking and selling 10,000 Uhuru Pies to support the programs of the Black Power Blueprint. You will learn more about this in the program. So I want you to enjoy today's program, and we also want you to get involved. Uhuru. 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 I'm sorry, y'all. Can we please stand to recite the African pledge? And raise your right fist, please. I pledge allegiance to my African people. I pledge to develop my mind and body to the greatest extent possible. I will learn all that I can in order to give my best to my people and our struggle for liberation through revolution. I will keep myself physically fit, building a strong body free from drugs and other substances which weaken me and make me less capable of defending myself, my family, and my African brothers brothers and sisters. I will unselfishly share my knowledge and understanding with others in order to bring about change more quickly. I will discipline myself to direct my energies thoughtfully and constructively rather than wasting time in idle hatred. I will train myself to never hurt or allow others to harm my African brothers and sisters, for I recognize that we need every African man, woman, and child to be physically, mentally, and psychologically strong. These principles I pledge to practice daily and to teach them to others in order to unite my people in the struggle for freedom and independence. Uhuru! Uhuru!
Uhuru! I hope you all feel welcomed after that. Let's give Station Manager Dia, the Joy Bringer, one more round of applause. And I'm excited for this part of the program because it is time for some cultural performances. Black Power 96 is the only radio station who offers local artists continuous opportunities to perform their music free from any stipulations placed on them by other white-owned and controlled media entities. First up, we have Pedro Losa. There's something about those. There's something about those slick lyrics and that NY accent. Maybe it's that smooth voice mixed with that hypnotic flow, or it just might be those pretty boy looks and that magnetic personality. Whatever it is, Pedro Losa has got it. Although he's no A-lister yet, his name is one that the world will soon know. You'll find it easy to compare him to artists like J. Cole, Drake, and Kendrick Lamar, but with dance moves like Chris Brown and a style that is so intriguingly unique that this kid is in the category of his own. Pedro says, quote, battling my sexual orientation as a child was tough. So at 11, I wrote my first song as an outlet and found my happiness in music, and I realized that I had a gift. The now 25-year-old entertainer proves that hard work, dedication, and perseverance still has a place in the music industry. Put your hands together for brother Pedro.
Thank you, Black Power 96. I go by the name of Pedro Losa. I was born in the Bronx, raised out in Queens, New York. Now I'm down here in Tampa, St. Pete area, working on my music. And as a young man raised from a black mother, I know the struggle of, you know, just sticking with your family and everything like that. So that's what we're here for, and we all just gather here today to have a good time. So my first song that I'm gonna be doing is called Mr. Perfect. DJ, whenever you're ready. Stand by. Black Power 96, we back, Power. Make some noise. Yeah. Tell me what I gotta do. Now I may not run it like Chris Brown, or see you in mirrors like JT. I ain't invent like Trey Songz or party with him and foreigns like JB. Nah, but I ain't trying to be none of them other. I'm trying to be the one to fit perfectly in your picture. I'm trying to give you the world because you deserve it. See, I'm just trying to be your Mr. Perfect. It's all right. It's all right. You could be my everything. I'ma do you right. I put that on everything now. Just let me know if it's worth it. I could be your Mr. Perfect now. I could be your Mr. Perfect now. Yeah, I could be your. I like your style and the way that you put it down. The way you rock your braids and whenever you crack a smile, I just can't help but to look your way. Not getting ever about what everybody say, cause they say this and they say that. But I can't let it bother me, can't get off track, cause baby. You know that I'm your Mr. Perfect, I'm what's best for you. It's all right, it's all right. You could be my everything, girl, I'ma do you right. I put that on everything now. Just let me know if it's worth it, ay. I could be your Mr. Perfect now. Let me know y'all feeling this. If y'all feeling this, make some noise, make some noise, make some noise. Y'all like the song? Yeah. Listen, can I be the mister to fit in your picture? You always looking fly, but you level up when I'm with you. I'm not the type of guy to give up. Hey, I start to lose my mind whenever you come around. Don't want to waste no time. You know that I'm pouring out my emotions. I do you better when bae's gone like an ocean. Soon, I get you wet and chase on. Hey, I get you, Trey Songz. It's all right, you could be my everything and I'ma do you right. I put that on everything now, just let me know if it's worth it. I bet you that I could be your Mr. Perfect now. I'm trying to tell you, baby, I could be your Mr. Perfect now. Listen, when I say I could be your Mr. Perfect. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Make some noise, baby, that's the first song. Mr. Perfect dropped last year, November 2017. Please go stream that, download, purchase everywhere. iTunes, SoundCloud, Spotify, YouTube, everything. Thank you. Yeah. Got one more song. We about to turn it up. So make some noise. I need some more energy tonight. I need some more energy, baby. We came here to have fun. And if you be feeling yourself, make some noise. If you're feeling yourself, you're feeling yourself. Let's go. Hey. It's my turn. You gon' learn. Better know to go up. That power. Pedro, Pedro. Pedro, 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 Pedro. I'm going in. Listen, listen. It's my go. Y'all know. I'm showing off. Now I got my bands up before. I say, what's up to the camera? No bandanas. Bro, don't get me wrong up in this. Go bananas. I'll be Donkey Kong, huh? I can never say no to eternal. Somebody pass it. We the ones keep the club jumping, jumping. We be running. No funny. Yeah, we lit. I don't know what you came to do, but it don't matter because we out here making major moves. Paying attention, I can show you a thing or two. Like how the money maker change your mood. Because I'm that dude that your girl want to see, that your dude want to be. Baby, I'm just being me. So it don't matter how much you front. No denying that I'm what you want. Black power, let's go. If you ain't know that, you gon' learn. It's your boy Pedro. Pedro, Pedro, Cause I go hard, go, go, I go hard, yeah. Go, go, I go hard, yeah. Go, go, I go hard, We go hard, black people, we go hard. That's right. Let's go, make some noise, make some noise, make some noise. It's no joke, never broke. Blow the money, get it right back. Call me Superman, I'm getting super cash, super fast. 100-meter dash, running through paychecks. Got him looking like, what he gonna do or say next? That's how it go when you rolling with me. I'm on the every day of the week. We got the club going, going up on a Tuesday. Forget what you say, we the... I don't know, hey, I see you over there. It don't matter, cause we out here making major moves. Pay attention, I can show you a thing or two. Like, how you do that? I'm that you wanna see, that you wanna be. I'm just being me. So it don't matter how much you front. No denying that I'm what you want. Cause I go, make some noise, y'all. Y'all beautiful crowd. Make some noise, baby, thank you. It's your boy Pedro. Pedro, Pedro. Pedro, Pedro, go hard. Hey, go, go. I go hard, yeah. Go, go. I go hard, yeah. Uh-huh. You know I'm the one. You know I'm turning up whenever I'm pulling up. You know I got that A. Hey. I get higher than the sun, God forgive me. I'm better than the devil, I confess it. Remember, if I put you on my level, that's a blessing. PD Cracker, mother, raw straight facts. On top of that, I'm cute, and you know that they hate that. It's my time. I told you, if you're feeling yourself, you better sing a song. If you're feeling yourself, you better make some noise. Cause I go hard, go, go. I go hard, yeah. Go, go. I go hard, yeah. Go, go. I go hard. I go hard. Hey, it's my turn, boy. If you ain't know, you gon' learn. It's your boy Pedro, uh-huh. Pedro, Pedro. Pedro, Pedro, Pedro. Say Pedro. Say Pedro. Say Pedro. Hey, I go hard. Go, go, I go hard. That song is called Go. I wrote, produced, performed. Everything, baby. I got a new project coming out this month. Make sure you go download that. It's going to be available on iTunes, SoundCloud, Spotify, YouTube. And I will be dropping a song on SoundCloud every week off the album. So make sure you guys go follow me on Pedro Losa Music. SoundCloud.com/Pedro Losa Music. You can find me on Instagram at It's Pedro Losa. And I just want to say thank you, Black Power 96, for having me. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for that. Uhuru.
Give it up one more time for Pedro, 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 Pedro. All right, so before I introduce this next speaker, one thing I realized, you know how, you know, when an artist is performing, they like to shout out the event, but it's so good having a radio station called Black Power 96, because when they shout us out, they have to say Black Power, like they just have to say it. So our next performer is Mr. Eddie, the Florida blind man, Maltsby. He was diagnosed with sarcoidosis at the age of 11. Doctors told him he would not live past 15 years old. The condition also left him blind. Now, Mr. Eddie has been playing his guitar and singing 8 hours a day for the last 34 years. He is also the host of the Florida Blind Boy Good Morning Gospel Show right here on Black Power 96 every Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7 to 9 a.m. Please put your hands together for Mr. Eddie, the Florida Blind Boy.
On and on. No, I'm sorry. I like that beat right there. Hey, everybody, how y'all doing? All right, a rule to all the Conrads, everybody that's here. Many of y'all probably seen me many times before singing downtown. Hey, baby, you close a moment. Hey, I. You know, I love the mic. Hey, boom. Y'all know I'm a comedian at heart. I'm going to sing a song or two and let you go, you know, have a little fun with you all today. A couple of songs you might know. I'll do right quick. One, a simple song, you follow along or whatever, and then I'll do something else or something, I don't know. But I want to thank Black Power for having me as a programmer, and thank you for joining me every Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays at 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. I play Good Morning Gospel for all those who might need a little encouragement to start their day. Always something I always say on the morning show, I'll say, if you're looking in the mirror and you see that you're black, remember, black is beautiful. So just keep that in your mind, you know, and keep your day going, you know. And I want to say thank you to everyone who's gave me a chance, because just like the young lady said, I've been singing downtown for 34 years, singing on the streets of Macorish. I remember Chairman Omali when he was going by another name. You know, I remember way back in the 70s. And for me to have a chance to be a programmer here is truly a blessing for me, because I was sitting there thinking after 33 years, what am I going to do next? You know, I can't play out here until I'm 90 or 80 or 70, whatever God's going to give me. But I was thinking of a new avenue, and up jumped Jesus. Up jumps Chairman Omali. Up jumps 96.3 FM. So I thank y'all, man. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. All right, you can put your hands together if you want to. I know a place, y'all. Ain't nobody crying. Oh, no. Ain't nobody worried. Ain't no smiling faces. Oh, Lord, lying to the races. Somebody help me now. I'll take you there. Somebody help me now. Yeah, I'll take you there. Eddie, little Eddie. Play your guitar now. Come on, Eddie. Y'all will play it. Oh, no. Yeah, come on now. I know a place, y'all. Heaven. Ain't nobody crying. Oh, no. Ain't nobody worried. Hey, yeah. Ain't no smiling faces. Oh, Lord, you're lying to the races. Somebody help me now. I'll take you there. Help me now, yeah, I'll take you there. Somebody help me now, yeah, I'll take you there. I can't hear you. Somebody help me now, sing. I'll take you there. Oh, say mercy, yeah.
I'll take you there.
Oh, come on, somebody. Hey.
I'll take you there.
Woo, come on and help me take you there. Whoa, I say help me take you there. Help me take you there. Somebody say, help me take you there. Thank you so much. I don't know what's gonna happen to you, hey, but I do know that I want you. Walk around with your head caught up in the sky, and you do know that I, woo! Come on, shake your body out to the ground, let's dance, and shout, shout. Shake your body out to the ground, girl, dance, and shout, shout. Shake your body out to the ground, let's dance, and shout, figure it over. You tease me with your loving to play hard to get, and you do know that I want you. Walk around with your head caught up in the sky, and you do know that I want you. Girl, let's dance and shout, shout. Shake your body onto the ground, let's dance and shout. Think it over. Body onto the ground, let's dance and shout, shout. Shake your body onto the ground, let's dance and shout. Woo! Yeah. Want to say thank you to Black Power 96. Thank you to all the comrades. Thank you for having me. Let's dance and shout, shout. Shake a body out to the ground. Let's dance and shout, shout. Shake a body out to the ground. Dance, shout. Shake a body out to the ground. Let's dance and shout.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chairman.
Let's keep keep the claps going. Give one more round of applause for Mr. Eddie. Keep it going. All right, so it is clear that St. Pete and the Tampa Bay is full of African talent. So next we will watch a video titled Because of You, which is a video coming to us from the Black Power 96.3 FM radio station. Uhuru.
Successfully raised the Black Pride 96 radio talk right here in local St. Pete. And so we're out measuring the coverage area and, you know, just assessing, you know, the expansion of our coverage area. Yeah, so, yeah.
So the sound of Black Power just got louder.
Exactly.
We went over the Skyway Bridge today.
Yes.
Over into Bradenton, and
which
we could hear the sounds of Black Power.
Because of you, Black Power 96.3 FM is growing, bringing the voice of African self-determination to the airwaves of St. Petersburg, Florida, and to online streams around the world. With more than 220 contributions from you, the individuals and businesses who make this station possible, we raise the amount needed to extend the height of our broadcast tower to 70 feet. That doubles our coverage area, and now we can be heard in historic Old Northeast, Fossil Park, Seminole, and Bay Pines. Because of our amazing show hosts and other station volunteers, the reach of Black Power 96 is also growing by being picked up by other stations that are rebroadcasting our show. Black Power 96 Radio has become a hub where community members can get involved in producing shows and helping to build a radio station that represents them, media in the hands of the black working class.
Uhuru, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to the special edition of My People's Keeper for the finale of the July
4th.
Yeah.
My team.
So, hey.
Watch your man. You should watch your mouth.
So we want to get into this real quick. Oh, shucky ducky quack quack.
What?
Y'all don't know.
Black Power 96 is the only station with a mission to defend the human and civil rights of the African community and to address the grave disparities in education, health, healthcare, and economic development faced by African people. We appreciate your continued support to keep Black Power 96 going strong and expanding to more live shows, more community events, and being a strong voice speaking in the interest of African people. Uhuru.
We set out and initiated a process first. We created an internet radio station, Uhuru Radio. And we always intended to be able to establish an FM station, and we succeeded in doing that finally. And so for the last couple of years, we've been able to be here with you. It is a low-powered FM station. We've extended our reach, however, using an app that allows us to reach out all around the world, and people around the world listen and participate with Black Power 96.3.
So what a wonderful video that was. Please, I'll wait until check. Please give yourselves a round of applause. Without you and your support, none of this would have happened. We have created and can maintain our own media, which we know is very, 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 very important. Next, I would like to bring up the Director of Agitation and Propaganda, who is also the Editor-in-Chief of the Burning Spear newspaper, Sister Akile Anayi. Uhuru.
Okay. All right. I like that. That's good. Uhuru! Uhuru! Before people can give a round of applause, I just really want to salute the work of Comrade Dia Kiesen Lugisan. He's the station manager of Black Power 96.3 FM. And everyone that he was able to organize to help build this monumental event, including collaborating with Uhuru Foods and Pies. I just want to salute that tremendous team. And, this event that is already just so inspiring, so moving. And, of course, I have to salute my leadership, Chairman Omali Yeshitela, for which all of this is even possible today, which I'm going to get into in a little bit. This is really amazing to see all these faces here, some people who I've never met before, who I'm just so appreciative of being able to see and meet you all this evening, and all of you participating in the celebration, because all of you have played a part in the, this monumental occasion of the raising of our Black Power Tower, which is no small feat. To think that, we are an organization, our radio station is one that doesn't take any resources, any big money from any politicians, any government officials, nothing like that. This is all powered by the people, and that's a statement within itself. That means it's owned and controlled by us, which means we get to set the tone for our own station. We get to define ourselves. We get to tell our own stories. We get to play our own music. And yes, it's black, black, blackity black, and we can be proud to say it because it's ours. It is ours. And now the African community gets access to their own black radio station, and white people now have to deal with the sounds of black power, and they can either get with the program or just continue to be annoyed by the fact that it is, you can't run from it, you can't hide from it. Black power is on the rise here in St. Pete and throughout the world. So I'm specifically here to talk about how, the struggle for black power continues. And, because there's a specific and a very important special date that is coming up within just a couple of days, and that is November 13th. And I'm going to talk about that in a moment, but I want to give, some historical context, because for a lot of us who are new to political life, period, whether you're younger or older, people are new to political life. Some people are new to this city and don't understand, just don't know about the struggle for black power, period, or specifically like in this city. And some people do have the benefit of that, but there has been a fierce struggle right here in the city of St. Pete that has launched a worldwide struggle for black power. And You know, if you're not familiar with the Black Revolution of the 60s, you know, we have to really get familiar with it, because there was a revolution that happened right here in the belly of the beast, right here in the United States. And, you know, that was the Black Revolution of the 60s. And, you know, it was something that really touched the world, and the world really looked to African people right here in this country and the leadership that we provided on this question. And, you know, it was because of the, you know, the basis, the pedestal to which this whole social system rests, this rotten, foul social system that we know that has, you know, committed genocide against African and indigenous people and continues to every single day, that, you know, rests on colonialism, the theft of Africa and African people from their land and dispersing them all around the world, and, you know, being dropped here to work to the bone for nothing, and to build the reality that white people get to live in every single day, poor white people and up, you know. That is the reality. And then slaughtered indigenous people here, stole half of Mexico and pushed Mexican people off of their own land. You know, this was, you know, this is a type of dirty, foul system that exists that the Black Revolution of the 60s sought out to crush. And in that struggle, you know, that was defeated by the U.S., by the U.S. government, by the counterinsurgency, by the counterintelligence program, you know, was defeated militarily, what was Chairman has called a war without terms, you know, just completely did everything they can, whipped out every weapon they had in their arsenal to really eradicate the revolution in this country, the Black Revolution specifically, because of what it meant for the world. And, you know, that was taking place in this country, and then it was defeated. But it was Chairman Omali Yeshitela right here in St. Petersburg, Florida, that kept it going. And we really have to understand that, because we're in the presence of the chairman. This is somebody who literally, quite literally, picked up the mantle of the what was left of the Black Revolution of the 60s and took it to where it is today. You know, it has brought us to this point today. Over 50 years of dedication to Africa and African people and this struggle to be free. And it was actually in this city where the first act of Black power was ever committed in 1966, in December of 1966. Not just in this city, but the first act of Black power in the world was when Chairman Omali Yeshitela tore down a racist mural that hung in City Hall. That character, you know, that's had this horrendous caricature of African people, you know, playing music and entertaining white beachgoers, which is a significant and telling display of how the system of white power feels about African people. And Chairman Omali Yeshitela tore that mural down and dragged it right back to the African community and was subsequently jailed, imprisoned, you know, for this act, which they, you know, so-called commend today. The original art critic, they jailed him and never gave him an ounce of credit, never gave him any kind of apology. And this is the man that carried the revolution from had being defeated up until this point today, reviving the revolution. That was Chairman Omali Yeshitela. And through many jailings and assassination attempts on his own life, he continued our struggle forward, organizing in the poorest sectors of our community, because that's what the revolution is. It's not with your pastors, it's not with the doctors, it's not with the lawyers, it's not with the big shots. It's with the African working class community. It's the ones who got to stand in the welfare lines. It's the one who have constantly, whose mothers, their children being, you know, snatched away from them by child protective services. It's the Africans around here riding on bikes with no shirts on, pants sagging. It's the African poor working class community to which the revolution exists. It's on our shoulders where we take it. It's the African working class, and it's the community that Chairman and our party, the African Socialist Party, has never been afraid to go. This Uhuru House sits in a poor working class African community. We have never been afraid of our own people, our own community, because we have always understood that this is where the revolution is. And Chairman organized the sectors of the poor sectors of our community throughout the South, pulling together the African People's Socialist Party and the Uhuru Movement, providing the political and ideological leadership to re-elevate the consciousness of our colonized communities. And his organizing, of course, it changed this city specifically. you know, this city that, you know, is, we know people come here to die. White people come here to die. This is a retirement city, retirement state, period. But, you know, white people, this is, you know, where they send their old, you know, their elderly here. And, you know, at where African people have historically and presently been the ones responsible for taking care of these white people that have war flashbacks and, you know, say horrendous things about African people, spit on African people, you know, just call them all kinds of names, and we have to clean their bedpans and all that. That's what African people have had to do for white people in this city. You know, for the big shots now, we had to do it for their grandmas and their granddads and, you know, all those people. As well as, you know, African people being responsible to clear the swamps of this city and, you know, Florida at large, clearing the swamps to create a tourist industry where African people have never benefited from. This, you know, this city is paradise. I don't know to whom, but the city is paradise, and, you know, everybody can travel here and all this kind of stuff. Yeah, that exists as a result of the back-breaking labor that African people had to endure for white people to get to enjoy that way of life, to enjoy that stuff, be able to come here and retire and live lavishly. African people were the ones who paved that way for them to be able to live, and they have lived at our expense ever since. And it was so it's been this city in the South that the chairman helped to raise the consciousness of our people and politically transform. It's this city right here. And that struggle from 1966 on, it rolled over into 1996. And this is the important date that everybody, you know, really has to remember, because this is our history. This is our history. This is the legacy of the African working class. What happened in 1996, where the St. Pete police murdered 18-year-old Tyron Lewis, an African 18-year-old child, baby fat in his face, gunned him down. The police did that. St. Petersburg Police Department did that right here. And this sparked a courageous rebellion from the African working class. And the first strike happened on October 24th, the day that Tyron Lewis was assassinated. And the second strike was on November 13th, which was the announcement of the verdict, where Sandra Minor and James Knight, the killer cops, got away with murdering Tyron Lewis, which we aren't surprised, because white power has continuously raped, killed, jailed, assassinated African people with impunity. That is the basis of this system. It gets away with murder every single day. So that wasn't the surprising factor. African people, of course, were upset. We're upset, we're outraged, because we don't want to see our people dying anymore. And the Uhuru movement was organizing a community meeting much like this that we had on a consistent basis. And the city tried to prevent Africans from coming to our meeting. They barricaded streets, back streets and all, trying to make sure that we could not get to the Uhuru House so that we could not meet to sum up the indictment, the verdict of James Knight and Sandra Minor. They didn't want us to be able to sum this up, because we're able to sum it up, we're able to organize in our own interests, and we're able to fight back in an organized fashion, which is something that the U.S. government in this city and everywhere can't handle, can't deal with. And so they attempted to keep the people away from us, but the people wanted to be here. And subsequent to that, they attacked this building. The city of St. Pete launched every ounce of tear gas they had in this city. They threw it right at this building, trying to start fires. But one of the important things was that, you know, Chairman Omali Yeshitela and leaders of our movement were in this building. They were trying to kill the leaders of the Uhuru movement. They were trying to kill this movement. It was the U.S. counterinsurgency all over again, trying to kill off the Black Revolution. That's what happened in 1996, November 13th, 1996. We can't ever forget that, because this city can never forget that, because we have to continue to fight for Tyron Lewis and all the Africans who continuously face genocide on a daily basis. So the city attacked this building, like I said, used every ounce of tear gas. They tried to kill this movement, but we were on the ground, we were out in the streets, and we were able to provide political leadership to these rebellions. And our people We're putting out the fires that the city tried to start. We shot down a police helicopter. And, you know, and they were giving them hell, giving the police arm to the teeth hell. With everything we had, our community fought back, and we won. We successfully defeated, yes, we won and successfully defeated an army of 300 police officers that they recruited from all over the place because they couldn't deal with the African community of St. Pete. They had to do all that, and they got their asses kicked by this community. And so we have to remember that. That's our history. That's what we come from. That's us. And that struggle, it continues today. We're in this room because that struggle continues today. You know, I don't know how many people are native to the city, but you don't even have to be native. You could have lived here probably, you know, 3 to 5 years, and you've noticed how drastically this city has changed, this community has changed, how fast they're moving in on African people here, kicking us out, rents going higher, all these houses now for sale, these, you know, all this construction happening. You see it, all these businesses, you've gone, closed down. You know, it started with, you know, early as the 90s with the Tropicana Field Baseball Stadium. They robbed this community of the gas plant district, and they built that dome on top of us. And up to this point where they're, you know, attempting to steal Jordan Park, take all of that land away from the African community. To an African man gave the African community Jordan Park, and the city is attempting to take it away. So you guys see that this is a war. This is genocide, an attack on our community. That's why the struggle continues. The white power has not given up. The city government has not given up. So it's our responsibility to fight back. Fight back against all of the things that we see today, all the acts of war and violence committed against our community. Because that's what that struggle represented on November 13th. It was, you know, beyond Tyron Lewis, because like I said, we see Tyron Lewis's every single day. You can't avoid Tyron Lewis's in a system of colonialism, imperialism, and parasitic capitalism. You can't avoid it. Tyron Lewis's will continue to happen so long as African people don't have power and control over our own lives. That's the reality that we're confronted against. But the struggle over that brother was a fight against gentrification, was a fight against, you know, unemployment, joblessness, homelessness, and ongoing police murders. That's what that struggle was for. And this is what our struggle is now. And, you know, we are in this community. We have a responsibility to continue this struggle forward. So, you know, of course, we want you to support, you know, and Black Power 96 radio station, as well as all the institutions that the Uhuru movement has been able to forward in this city and throughout the U.S., which you're going to hear about today through the Black Power Blueprint and other things like that. You know, that is a testament to us never giving up, you know, for us always, you know, always fighting and always keeping it moving. And that's what we have a responsibility to do. So, you know, I want you guys to support Black Power 96, because that's such an important institution. I explain how significant this radio station is to this city, but for Africans everywhere, because Africans can access this radio station everywhere. This is so important. You know, media and having our own media apparatus for the revolution is important. We all know past revolutions and how significant their own newspaper was, their own journal, and their own radio was in aiding the revolution, and we have our own now. So we have to support it, and we have to support our economic development institutions like Uhuru Foods and Pies that forward the mission for Black power and self-determination in our lifetime. We don't have to wait for it. We don't have to ask for it. We can do it because we are doing it right now. And I want you all to support, but more than that, I want you to join in the struggle, continuing and finally completing, bringing to conclusion the Black Revolution of the 60s. And, you know, with that, it really is a profound honor of mine to be able to introduce this next speaker, the person who I've talked about throughout this whole presentation, the one who picked up the mantle and single-handedly led our people, is leading our people to victory, the leader of the African nation, Chairman Omali Yeshitela, Uhuru.
Uhuru. Uhuru. Thank you, brothers and sisters and comrade director Akili Anai. She's extremely important to our party, to our movement, that is to say, comrade Akili. She is the director of what we call agitation and propaganda. In other words, she leads this struggle of African people in the war of ideas that we're involved in. That's what you talk about. When you talk about the radio station having the ability to communicate, we are engaged in a war of ideas. And Akili has taken up the mantle and has been doing an incredible job. And as the director of agitation and propaganda, she's responsible for the radio, she's responsible for the newspaper, she's responsible for the political education for the entire party all around the world. She's responsible for the political education that we take out to the people wherever we're located. And so I just wanted to really express my appreciation. She's a young woman. Which is also some testimony to who we are as an African People's Socialist Party. Because, as you know, this country and most of Europe are not without certain kinds of prejudices when it comes to the leadership of women, and certainly not without prejudice when it comes to the leadership of African women. Probably next to, along with African young people, the most slandered people on the planet Earth are African women and young people. And so I think that that it is very, very important, because she's both young and African woman, and that's a statement of who we are as a party. So this event that we are doing today is part of this war of ideas that we are involved in. And most of us are not aware of the fact that we are in a war of ideas, where the ruling media, the representatives of the ruling class, their thinking representatives, the ones that control radio, you dissatisfied with what you hear in terms of rap music? African people don't control rap music, don't control what you hear, even though they learn how to do what white people want them to do if they're going to be successful. So you have to have a bunch of bees and thieves and killings and stuff like that in rap music for it to sell. And everybody learns the formula. There's a formula that you learn to be successful. And if white power didn't want it, you wouldn't have it. And it's exactly, and the majority of the people who listen to rap music are not black people, it's white people.
Right.
That's partially because of the number of white people as compared to Africans in this country. So that's who you're playing for. And when you hear rappers singing about bees and all of the other negative and dirty things that rappers are promoting, when those white people are listening to that rap sound, they don't see white women when they see those bees, and they hear the bees and stuff like that. They see Africans. And that's what it means in terms of the war of ideas and somebody controlling the apparatus that produces and distributes ideas in the world. And if you live in a society that has its basis in slavery and colonialism, the ideas of the ruling circles will promote colonialism and slavery, and promote those things that will produce and reproduce slavery and colonialism. It will promote the ideas that produces and reproduce colonialism and slavery. So that's what this war of ideas is all about. It's not a small thing. And I'm extremely happy to see those of you who have come out, because you have to take a responsibility for this war of ideas that we're engaged in. Because the ruling circles give you the impression that what you're hearing on the radio is free. That you can turn on your radio and you can hear stuff all the time. It's free. They don't have to worry about raising an antenna a few feet. You can hear them all over, everywhere. It's we who have to struggle to be heard. But you can hear them all over, everywhere. Because they are the dominant force in this society. And they want their message to get out. And their message is so difficult to even get a radio station license. And the struggle that we had to go through just to get this license is incredible. So you coming here means that you have accepted this responsibility yourself as individuals to participate in the struggle of the war of ideas. Because we can't do this. This is what they call public radio, or what the people have to, community radio that relies on contributions and donations from the people in order to be successful, or to have the programs that we need. And we need a lot of programs. We need a lot of programmers. We need resources to up our equipment, not just the antenna, but all the other equipment we need. We need to be able to do remote broadcasting. We need to be able to do 1,000 different things. We need to have more programmers and more skilled programmers. We need to be able to produce that. That takes money. We're not the corporations. We're not Disney and all these other forces who take your money. There are about 6 corporations that control more than 96%, 99% of the media in this country. They take your money, every DVD that you used to buy, all of the resources that you put into them, that's what they use now to use it against you. So here with Black Power 96, you get an opportunity to take a step to control the ideas that your community is going to be able to hear. You hate it. I heard you say how much you hate the dirty lyrics on rap music and other things like that. I heard you say how you hate the slander that comes against our community through the media. And I know it's true. So what we have done is create this instrument, this institution, in this war of ideas. And in so doing, we arm the people. We arm you. We arm all of the people who are out there who want this radio station. But we are not accustomed to paying for our own radio station. We pay for their radio station every time we use Disney. Every time we go to something that's controlled by Comcast, we are paying for their radio station. What we are saying is we voluntarily get involved in paying for our own radio station. So we can hear Brother Eddie. Where's Brother Eddie again? Yeah, we can hear Brother Eddie on a regular basis. I remember Brother Eddie there on Central Avenue near McCrory's. It was near McCrory's. We got to McCrory's with that mural, Brother Eddie, before the police actually had the courage to try to arrest us. But I remember that brother there, and he was, why was he there? He was there because there was no other instrument available to him. There was no other means for him to express the culture that he has available for our community. So this war of ideas is important. And your presence here, I really hope, means that you accept the responsibility not just to come out and hear Brother Eddie and this incredible, was it Pedro? You know, not just for that, but also to volunteer to assume responsibility for the success of your radio station. This is yours, and we have to assume responsibility for it. All these programmers that we've got people, Dia never ran a radio station before, but he was ready and willing to do it because he jumped in the battle, in this war of ideas. That's what it is that I'm hoping you will do. Now, I just want to say that November 13th was something that was mentioned to you. But also, it was mentioned to you about December 29th, 1966, when I tore that mural down. This is a statement of how important the war of ideas is, because that mural was a caricature of black people. It was 10 by 8 feet that it hung on the wall of the center of power in the city, or the city hall. There's this huge mural that presented us in caricature. Black people with huge pink lips all over our faces and arms that reached down to our knees and things like this. This was in the city hall. And when we told them to remove it, the mayor sent some really insulting letter back to us refusing to remove it. Now, that mural was a part of the war of ideas. That mural reflected what white power thought of us and what it wanted everybody else to think of us. This was a reminder that this is who the niggas are. This is who these people who live in these communities without paved streets, who live in the communities where every time it rains, it's going to be difficult to even get through the community, who are restricted to a 2-square-mile area of the another city, whose mothers get up every morning to be picked up by white men who will come, or white women who will come in their cars and put them in the back seats to leave their own children and then go and take care of white babies. This is what these people are to understand we are as a consequence of that mural. This is a statement that's been made to them, and it's a statement made to you. So every day you go to City Hall, you don't say anything, you just hold your head down and pass that nasty message that they're holding up to the world. That's a war of ideas. So we disagree with that. They say this is art. We disagree with that. And we took the damn mural down. We took it down. And said that we're going to take it to the African community and see what black people think about this mural. And they charged me with 11 offenses for doing this. 11 offenses for doing this. They sentenced me to 5 years in prison on one of those charges for taking that mural down. Because they don't want anybody to challenge the notion that they give, the definition of who we are, that they give us, they don't want that challenge. In fact, when they put me on trial, my lawyer came and said to me that, listen, they want to put you on trial and they want to ask you if you would do it again, if you would do it again, all you got to do is say, no, I'm sorry, I wouldn't do it again if I had an opportunity. But if I said that, it would be making a statement to my community, to my people, that I am so cowardly that I don't really have the courage to stand up for black power, that I concede and surrender to the opinion that white people have of me and of us. I could not surrender to that. So they gave me 5 years in prison. It's a war of ideas. When they killed Malcolm X, they didn't kill Malcolm X because he was running around with guns or robbing people and things like that. They killed him for what he said. They killed him for the ideas that he represented. When they killed King, they didn't kill King because he was robbing and looting or anything like that, because he was even assumed to be a thief. They killed him for what he said, because they did not want those ideas to be spread. It's a war of ideas that we are involved in, and you have to voluntarily take part in this war of ideas. That's why this is so important. And this war of ideas, the reason that you don't know about November 13th, because they don't put it out on a regular basis. That mural was taken down 52 years ago. That wall is still blank. It's still blank. The 8x is still blank. They've tried to put something up there, but every time they try to put something up there, I say, if you put it up, I'm gonna take it down again. And so they wanna stop, they don't want this discussion to continue. They said the nigga gonna die someday. We can put it up there. They don't want to have this discussion, but we are having this discussion. And because we are having this discussion, it means they'll never be able to put anything up on that place again. This is the war of ideas. This is the war of ideas that we're involved in. And you don't know about November 13th, when just a couple of weeks after they murdered this child in the streets, they murdered Tyrone Lewis. On October 24th, they murdered him in the streets. And African people saw the murder. And they testified that it was murder. And then yet, they took it for a grand jury. And the grand jury said that the police committed no offense when they murdered that child. They came up with a lie. They said that Tyrone Lewis had crack cocaine in the car, he had stolen the car, and that these good white cops who simply tried to stop him because they were speeding and stepped in front of the car, then got hit by the car and pushed up on the hood of the car, and it's only in self-defense that they had to kill that child. That's what they said. And they were lying. And a year later, on the anniversary of his murder, the St. Petersburg Times wrote an article that said that immediately after they killed this Tyrone Lewis, Now, they took pictures of the cop's legs because he was wearing short pants. There was no evidence of any kind of bruise on his legs. Not only that, there was no fingerprints of the cop on the hood of the car. The only place the fingerprints was right on the front of the car, that he put his hands on the front of the car. They knew he was lying. And the car was not stolen. And there was no crack cane, but even if it was a stolen car with a trunk full of cocaine or crack cocaine, you don't stand in front of it and murder somebody because you are the judge and the jury and the executioner. You can't do that and get away with it. Because we used to call that what it is, lynching. It's a public lynching when you don't even go to the courthouse or the courtroom. You don't pretend that law applies to this person, you just murder him. Then you put in the newspaper, their newspaper. They put in the newspaper that he had a record. The first thing you see the morning after is a mugshot where he had been arrested before. This is the war of ideas that we're involved in. And you walk around too saying, well, he did have a record. He must have done something. And those lick-spittle Negroes that you call leaders always come and unite with everything that they want to do. November 13th was the day that the grand jury was supposed to come back with its verdict to determine whether or not James Knight and Sandra Minor, how much does that say?
That says two.
It's going to be longer than that. And Sandra Minor should be indicted for murdering Tyrone Lewis. And of course, they came back and said, no, don't indict him. And the community rose up in a rebellion. After the police attacked this building, where we were having a meeting with the community to talk about the rebellion. And they used all the tear gas in the city of St. Petersburg. And they had more than 300 cops that they had brought from the city, from neighboring cities, and the highway patrol. They brought them all to attack this building. War of ideas. The city had already said that they were concerned about what we were going to say to the people about the grand jury's verdict not to indict these guys. And they didn't want to hear us say. They said they began to arrest our people preemptively right out here in the streets of St. Petersburg. A war of ideas. Shut up, nigga! You understand? And because we wouldn't shut up and we were determined to speak the truth that they did this, I want to say just a couple of things. So part of what I really want to say is that you have to support this radio station. Yeah. It's your radio station. You support all those other stuff, support this radio station. Support it with your talent, with your money. I was once on a radio station in Tampa. That's supposed to be one of these, what do you call it? Is it, what do you call it, public or community? Say it again. Public radio station, where the people donate and keep it running. The program that I was on, the one that I was a part of, raised more money than any of the programs when it was fundraising time. But they didn't want us on here. Because they thought we was the NAACP or somebody. They thought we were just going to come down and give a regular endorsement to the murder and mayhem they commit against our people. I remember once this woman got really upset because we were talking about black people need to control our ability to educate ourselves, educate our children, educate our people. And that what we had now was a system in this city where all everything that's about desegregation goes to white people, the white community. You go through this city, every place, through this county, and what you will see is these magnet schools. The magnet schools create special education for white people in otherwise black institutions to get white people willing to come to this community so they can call it desegregation. So they reward, they bribe white people. And here you are, your children going to the same school. They got two schools in one. Yeah. One for the white people who are bribed to come here in the magnet school in a desegregation program. Desegregation, they said, was supposed to be for you. But they don't talk this. You don't hear this on a white radio station. And so this woman, I was on the radio station, she called up and she said she was really concerned about what I was saying. Because about black people controlling our own school and community control of our own schools, because she says that, you know, her child, she has a child, and she's so happy, this white woman, that her children now has an opportunity to be in a situation that they call, what do they call this, cultural, what do they call it?
Diversity.
And she was never so happy. And she, and the whole station got upset when I said, my children do not go to school to provide your white children with a diversity experience. We do not exist to give your child some experience of diversity. We send the child to school. We want that child to be armed educationally, ideologically, mentally, to be able to navigate this horrible world that that child has inherited. So they were upset with that because I was not polite. So I want to say this quickly, because I do believe in discipline, despite the fact that I'm acting very indisciplined now. But y'all, can I see the hands of people who are going to support this radio station? All kind. We want your talent. We want your money. You don't have to give us as much as you give Disney or any of the other ones. But we want it. We have to have it to be successful. And I want to say that another thing that's significant about today is that they call it Memorial Day. And I could not stand before you without Veterans Day. Memorial Day is in May, right? I couldn't stand before you without saying something about that, because they're raising these red, white, and blue and patriotic nonsense everywhere. It used to call it Armistice Day. And armistice is what? Peace. But they changed it to Veterans Day, right? And Veterans Day is the honor of the people who made war. And it was the veterans organizations, national veterans organizations, which means that these are organizations of state power that pushed to have it changed to Veterans Day. And I was listening to radio, I was rather watching on Facebook today. And I saw people who I really respect who were talking about how their father was in World War II, and you know, and he was a veteran, and you know, that was really something. And then I heard a radio program today about black veterans not treated as well as white veterans, and wow, wow, wow. But Veterans Day or Armistice Day is something that came about in 1908 as a consequence of this. It's a celebration, if you will, of the end of the First Imperialist War in 1918. But what they do not say, first of all, is that the war was a war to redivide the world among white imperialist bandits. Yeah. The war to end all wars was a war to redivide the world between white imperialist bandits. And out of that war, they created what they call a League of Nations. That was something engineered by U.S. President Woodrow Wilson. But he blew it and did not bring the rest of the Congress with him on that. And so they created the League of Nations, which was supposed to be something that was going to make peace forever, just like the United Nations. And this peace forever was going to come about as a consequence of this league of white powers dominating the rest of the world, who would never have to fight each other anymore over colonial people, because they had this relationship. They were going to govern the world collectively among themselves. That's what it was for. So we had the war to end all wars. Ended officially on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. That's how they characterize it, right? Of 1918. But what they didn't say is the summer of 1919 and the autumn of 1919, they call it the Red Summer. And they call it the Red Summer because in more than almost 40 cities around this country, white people mobs attacked African people, burned their houses, murdered them in the streets. They call it the Red Summer. And partially because these Africans who were veterans in that war had the audacity to come home and assume, or come to America, let me put it that way, and assume that they should have some kind of rights and be willing to fight for it. And so you had all over this country, more than almost 40
some more than 36 of these riots by white people that they call a red summer. So I'm just saying, here you are talking about the big sacrifices that you made and how you don't get treated as well as a white veteran, as a white mercenary, which is all they are, because the U.S. Army, U.S. military is incapable of fighting a just war, and every war it has fought has been an unjust war, and if you participated in that war, you fought on the side of somebody engaged in an unjust war. If you were in Vietnam, you participated in a war, in an unjust war. If you were in the Second Imperialist War, it was what they call World War II, you participated in an unjust war. If you went to Syria, or if you went to Saudi Arabia to fight somewhere in the Middle East, you're participating in an unjust war. It is a war of colonial white domination of the world. And the reason you don't know about it is because you don't give enough money and support to Black Power 96. Uhuru.
All right, one more round of applause for Chairman Omali Yeshitela. I know he just asked the question, but I want to ask it again just so that I can have my own, you know, opinion. And Dia, pay attention. Who here is going to support Black Power 96.3 FM? All right, okay, we got, we remember. So, ready? So while we are doing these sets changes, I just want to remind everybody that once this event is over, to please check out our vendor tables. We have the, Betty, can you raise your hand? The Omali Yeshitela table, which has the Burning Spear newspaper that was spoken about earlier, as well as books written by Chairman Omali Yeshitela. Flyers for, you know, the cruise, which will be announced a bit later today, as well as other things that come out of the office of the chair. Gabby, can you raise your hand? We have the Burning Spear table, which you can actually pre-order the chairman's newest book, which will be released in February of 2019. It is the political report that he has written to the 7th Congress of the African People's Socialist Party, which just took place this October in St. Louis, Missouri. And we have the Black Power 96 table. DJ Asada, can you raise your hand? Which has Black Power 96 lanyards, t-shirts, fanny packs, red, black, and green flags. It has these little, can you hold that little box up? Which you can take one, and over the period of 96 days, you can put all of your loose change in there, or, you know, dollars or whatever, and raise $96 in 96 days. Come back to the radio station. So if you are not going to make one of our pledges that are going to be mentioned shortly, you can donate via that avenue as well. We are going to do a pod tasting today, but you can also get your own Uhuru pod. You can also sign up to be a seller. So that's at that table. You can speak to Janice. Janice, raise your hand. Yeah, I know. I'm also asking, are we ready? Yeah. We ready? All right, so I would like to bring up to the stage station manager Dia Kiesi, as well as Gazi Koza, the Secretary General of the African People's Socialist Party. Uhuru, round of applause. Thank you.
What's up, y'all? Make some noise. Can we get one more round of applause for that fire presentation by Chairman Omali Yeshitela of the African People's Socialist Party? So Lower that for me, DJ. Lower that for me. All right, y'all. So it's time to raise some coins. Everybody can participate in this. My co-appealer, is your mic on? Is it on?
No. Wait, is that it? Okay, yes.
All right, y'all know me. I'm Dia, the station manager, and this is the Secretary General of the African People's Socialist Party, Gazi Koza. Y'all give it up. All right, so, you know, we've heard so many wonderful things today, and, you know, again, we are expressing appreciation to you, the community, who has helped us raise our radio tower, and again, So now we want to give everybody an opportunity to participate, and, you know, as stated throughout the celebration, this is your radio station. Black Pride 96 belongs to the people, and, you know, we fight against the colonial propaganda machines, and we bring the voice of the African working class to the airwaves, wouldn't you say? That's right, SG. And there is no radio station like Black Pride 96 anywhere. Nowhere in existence will you find a station like Black Pride 96. So today, we want to raise some resources for the station, and we have a goal.
What's our goal?
We have a $700 goal for today.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes. So, yeah, you think we could do it?
I know we can do it. Seven is the lowest number. It is. Seven days?
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so what we want to do now is show a video of Black Pride 96's campaigns and our victories up until this point. So, Uhura. Thank you. Uhuru.
All right, all right.
Testing.
Do that. All right, y'all. Y'all ready to raise some money?
Yeah.
I said, y'all ready to raise some money for Black Power? Let me hear over here. Y'all say Black Power real quick. Black Power!
Black Power!
Uh-uh, y'all don't want no Black Power. Y'all must want White Power. Mm-mm, y'all, that's too much George Bush over there. Say Black Power!
Black Power!
Okay, that's a little Black Power, a little Hillary Clinton, little... Get in the middle. Come on, the middle making me feel it. This middle making me feel it. I see family on this table. I see family. Homosexuals in the building. But anyways, in the middle. Say Black Power.
Black Power.
Black Power.
Black Power.
Black Power.
Black Power.
Okay, that's Marcus Garvey Lane right here. Right here. All right, now the whole crowd say Black Power.
Black Power.
Oh, that's beautiful. Black Power. That's right. Thank y'all for that. Gotta lively it up. This ain't PBR. All right, this is Black Power. All right, what's next, station manager? I was going to sleep. I had to wake up.
Is my mic?
His mic's not on, y'all. That's why we need the donations.
Testing. All right. So next, what we want to do is go through our different levels of memberships so you all can know, you know, what contribution you can make. But before we do that, is there anybody in the building who just want to drop that 7,000? Because, I mean, 700, because some people just got it like that, you know. Like,
yes. Who got 700 in the building? Who got 700? Sister, don't you laugh. You look like you got a good sugar daddy. Call him, girl. Call Craig.
Next
tell
slide.
Him, don't tell his wife. Call him. Get that
next
700.
Slide. Next slide, Robert, please. So our first level, which is our highest level, and that is going to be the Marcus Garvey level. And we have two different types of supporting memberships that you can have. You can be a supporting member or you can be a sustaining member. A sustaining member is someone who sustains the station on a monthly basis, meaning that you would contribute every month and we can set it up where the amount that you set is taken out of your account each month. And starting with Marcus Garvey, you can donate as a supporting member, just give a donation from $296 and up, or you can donate at $25 a month as a sustaining Marcus Garvey level supporting member. So do we have anyone who would like to be a Marcus Garvey supporting member?
$25. Oh, there we go. $25 a month. And another one, okay. What that shirt say? Can you stand up, please? That says Andrew Gillum. Shouldn't you be counting votes, sir? Shouldn't you be still counting votes? Y'all didn't give up, goddamn. I'm like, is the election over? Shoot, it's February, y'all still count.
Anybody
but
else?
For the 25. Anyone else for the 25?
Sustaining member, or you can just make a donation.
That's
at 25.
That's it. That's not even a pair of Jordans. That's 25.
And I also want to recognize our comrade Iquan, who has the basket
Woo-woo!
Over here. So he'll be collecting the resources.
Yes,
next slide.
With that dashiki. Iquan, I like that bracelet. That's good. Give it back to your mama when you're done. All right, let's go.
Next slide, please. Next, we have...
I love the children. Be creative. Next, be creative. Do you. Be you.
We have our...
Gender's not real.
Next, we have our Bar Marley level, which is our second highest level, and you can donate $96 and above now,
yes.
Or as a sustaining member, you can donate at $10 a month.
$10 a month. Who got that? Okay, over there, Ted. All right, Ted. Okay, Ted. That's what's up behind me, Ted. All right, that is what is up. I appreciate y'all for that. Ted for the brother in the back. That's beautiful.
Anybody else at the Bar Marley level?
Don't break nothing now. Yes.
All right, so.
How many tens you got there?
Huh?
Three. I counted more than three.
Who else you got?
Okay. Put your hand up if you did 10.
So we got one right here.
Yes.
We got a sister right here.
Girl. That's
what's
my
your
girl.
Name, sis? What's your name?
Nicole. Nicole. Yeah. Girls in the cold are always pretty. Always pretty. They mean shady, but always pretty.
What's your name, brother?
Daniel Michael. Oh. Daniel Michael. Thank you for that, Daniel.
Michael
bro. Thank
you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I think I saw another hand we have. What's your name, sir?
Mikey. Mikey. All right, Mikey. Thank you for the 10.
And I think I saw one more. Oh, I got.
Akile. Thank you, Akile, for the 10 on it.
Okay, so that's it for the Bar Molly level. Nobody else? Oh, we got one right here.
Uhuru. Okay. Round of applause for everybody that's donated so far.
Mm-hmm.
We got Dorothy.
All right, and lastly, our last level is the incomparable Nina Simone level. And today, as a supporting member, you can donate anywhere between $5 to $95 right now, or you can become a sustaining member at $5 a month for the Nina Simone level. So I know everybody could do that. We got this sister right here. We got two right here. Matter of fact, Aquan, come here real quick. Just so I can record everyone's name, please just take the mic and pass it to the people who raised their hand. So I think it was two of them.
And if you are online, please also put how much you're going to donate online, and someone will be reading it out. Her.
Santosh.
Santosh. And Tosh. What that mean?
Happy.
Happy? Oh, that's beautiful. All
right.
What was the other person?
It was her. Anyone else
at the Nina Simone level? Who wanted to donate $5 to the Nina Simone level? Did y'all see what they did to Nina Simone in that movie? Uh-huh. They had that light girl playing her. They made her go in blackface. Y'all forgot that? Mm-hmm. What's her name? Soledad? Zoe Soledad. That's crazy.
Destiny.
Destiny. Thank you, Destiny. Yes. Which Destiny child is you? As long as you ain't Michelle.
Can I say your name as well?
Yvonne.
Anyone else at the Nina Simone level? Nina Simone, that was a fierce woman. Yvonne. That's what's up. Well, can we get the people that donated the Bob Marley level to say your name?
What's the website?
Oh, Black
Panther. Aquan, the brother right behind
you. My name is Larry Faison.
Thank you. Round of applause. Oh, we got some online. DC owner, Bob Marley level. Round of applause.
Eddie Sampson, Bob Marley level. Eddie Sampson.
Eddie Santos, round of applause for Eddie. Sampson.
Black Car 96.
Yeah, you can go. Go to the.
We take swipe. We take cash. We take coins. Mm-hmm. We take IOUs. We take EBT.
Thank you.
What you got? We take it.
Did you want to say your name as well?
Oh, I did.
Oh, you did? Oh, okay.
What level, Penny?
$50.
$50. Okay. Round of applause. Fitty in the house.
All right,
y'all, no need to get quiet and nervous. This ain't your bill collector. We ain't your landlord. Relax. We just raising some money. Say Black Power!
Black Power!
Black Power!
Black Power!
All right. How much we at now? You got to do it with the whole year.
Robert, you donated? How much? Thank you for that. Thank you.
Uhuru, Diane, I'll do.
Okay, Ashley, Uhuru. What do you say?
I'm already at 10 a month, but I can't have 5 to it.
Oh, you about to up it?
15, I can't do 25.
Okay, gotta ease in there. You gotta ease in there. All right, thank you.
All right,
you got Ashley?
Oh, Diane, I'll give 20. I think I'm already a $10 a month member for a long time, but I'll do 20 today.
You're gonna up it 20?
Well, I'll give 20 now.
Okay, yeah, okay, okay.
All right. I mean, whenever you can swipe this, I'll do the 10 for the bottom money level.
Okay, but what's up?
Dear,
do we have a card?
Yeah. All right. 10 for the Bob Marley. Yep. Yeah. You say 10 for the Bob Marley. Yep. But it's Chip Daniel. Yep.
Yes. Gotta donate some more. You got it, dear?
I don't have my checkbook, like, right on me. Where can I pay by card?
Oh, well, I'm about to go
grab Nana Ya, Marcus Garvey. Shout out to Nana Ya, who just donated online, Marcus Garvey level. That's $25 a month.
Yeah.
Dia still calculating. Just give it some time. You doing that, man? How you doing that, Maya? Uh-huh, then you carry the one. Well, we made the goal. We made the goal. Oh, wait. All right, y'all. Are y'all ready to find out the total? Y'all think we made the 700? Yeah. I don't know. Y'all think we made it?
Yeah.
Y'all not believers. You know, my mama's a good Christian woman, and she says you have to speak it into existence, okay? You have to say it loud enough so God's ears hear you, because he real foreign stuff. Y'all believe we made it?
Yeah.
Y'all believe we made the goal?
Yeah.
Say money. Okay, Dia, tell the people.
All right, cool.
Did we make the 700? Did we do it, Lord?
Our total amount,
mm-hmm.
with your sustaining support and your support, we have a total of $2,757.
Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Yes!
I just really want... you know, we definitely appreciate our supporting members, but our sustaining members, you are the lifeline for Black Pride
96.3
FM. And, you know, as Chairman stated, we don't receive any type of money from any outside corporation or anything else of that nature. It's the power of the people. And so, yeah, Uhuru.
Uhuru.
And anyone who needs to use your card to make your donation, you can see me at the end of the program, and we'll be ready to take your donations. And I definitely want to shout out Deputy Chairwoman Ona Zanae Yeshitela, who again is the president of the African People's Education and Defense Fund. And without APEDF, without the leadership of Deputy Chairwoman, Black Pride 96 would not exist. So we definitely have to give a tremendous acknowledgement and shout out to DC Ona.
Woo!
Uhuru.
Alikia.
Start it over. Because this is a Black Power 96 event, and James Brown just said, say it loud, and nobody said, I'm black and I'm proud. Come on. One more time. There you go. That sounds more like it. You gotta be on cue for that song. Like, it doesn't matter where you are. If that song comes on, you have to scream out, I'm black and I'm proud, okay? So, I want to thank SG Ghazi and station manager Dia Kiesi for that wonderful appeal. But most importantly, I want to thank everybody here who just, you know, contributed to, you know, this station, you know, continuing. Before we continue, I would like to just go into the announcement segment of this program, as Akile would say. We stay tuned for the delicious caramu that we have after this event. A caramu. Caramu is a word that means feast. And today's menu is baked chicken, vegan lasagna, cornbread, salad, and fruits. So exciting. That's really exciting. And also, my next announcement is for us to sign up. Well, not us, but everybody here, not just, you know, us, but everybody, y'all, to sign up for the 2018 Marcus Garvey Legacy Cruise. How many of you guys know what that is? Good. That means I get to bring new information. Wait, somebody said heard it on the radio? Ah, see, look at that. So the Marcus Garvey Legacy Cruise is an annual fundraiser cruise taken to support the African Socialist International. And just in a really short sense, the African Socialist International is the umbrella organization that brings us the African People's Socialist Party that we heard about today, that brings us the African People's Education and Defense Fund that we've heard about today, that brings us Black Power 96.3 FM, that brings us the Burning Spear newspaper, and all of these other, that brings us Uhuru Foods and Pies, and all of these other institutions that we, you know, have talked about and seen just being here these past few hours are all housed under the African Socialist International. So it is a week-long cruise. You get to, you know, not cook, not clean, you know, just not even answer phone calls, just, you know, get away from everybody, but also be, you know, with your friends, family, and your loved ones for a whole week while you sail through the Caribbean. This year's cruise is taking place from December 9th to 16th, and it is sailing from Miami, Florida. Although I just said December and we're in November, it is not too late to sign up. So even if, as you're hearing this today, for those online or for those here, it's not too late to sign up. We are sailing from Miami, Florida to Grand Cayman of the Cayman Islands to Mahogany Bay, which is in, you know, Honduras or Rotan, to Belize, and finally to Cozumel, Mexico. And, you know, we do have some yellow packets. Betty, can you raise your hand again? Right here at the Omali Yeshitela table. So that has all the pricing and all this other information there. We have the ability to sign people up here. Just come to me after this event and we can sign you up. We also have a clipboard that if you can't, you know, make your payment today, that we can get your contact and call you, and you'll be added to our HTML list. To receive updates not only about this cruise, but again, it's an annual cruise, but every cruise that we take next year. Chairman Omali Yeshitela will be the keynote speaker throughout the whole cruise. And what's different with cruising with the Marcus Garvey Legacy Cruise is that although we're doing excursions, we're doing all these, you know, onboard activities like karaoke and nightclubs and casinos and swimming pools and fitness centers and all of that stuff, but we also get political education throughout the cruise. So at each excursion, besides whatever other excursion is there to do, we also learn about the history of African, or in some cases, indigenous people at those particular locations. And then on one of the days of the week, we also have an inside political education with Chairman Omali Yeshitela, where he will make a dynamic presentation just like he did earlier today. For those online, you can call the travel agent, Linda Stern, at 732-972-4171 or visit uhurulegacycruise.org. So, feel like it's you, you might as well just go check. But within the Uhuru movement, we understand that it is the people who are the makers and shapers of history. Black Power 96 and Uhuru Foods and Pies are powered by our magnificent volunteers, and we would not be here without you. So now we are about to have a few words from the Uhuru Foods and Pies. All right, Uhuru.
Uhuru, thank you very much. My name is Janice Kant. I'm a member of the African People's Solidarity Committee, and I have the honor of coordinating Uhuru Foods and Pies here in St. Petersburg. I'm a member of the African People's Solidarity Committee, which works under the leadership of the African People's Socialist Party to organize white people to solidarity with African liberation and for reparations to African people. Uhuru Foods and Pies is one of the dynamic institutions of Black Star Industries, which is the brainchild of Chairman Omali Yeshitela. Named after the Black Star steamship line of the Garvey movement, it is 21st century Garveyism. I should move, shouldn't I? Oh, Jesus. Sorry. The mission of Black Star Industries is building economic development and commerce for and between African people worldwide. And I really want to salute my leadership, Chairman Omali Yeshitela, and thank the chairman for African internationalism that allows us in the white community to overturn our 600-year violent and oppressive relationship to African people in a principled and organizational way under the leadership of the African People's Socialist Party. Uhuru Foods and Pies is about putting the means to grow, produce, and distribute fresh food in the hands of African people. The vision is to control the land, farms, trucking, baking, cooking, and distribution of food. African people once again control these. Black Star Industries is about reversing the theft of land, resources, and labor of African people that have come from colonialism. It's not a business owned by an individual. It's an institution of African self-determination, bringing all the resources and commerce back to the African community. It's creating an independent economy in the African community. Since its inception in 1972, the African People's Socialist Party has always been economically independent, raising funds to support the political work through picking oranges in groves of Florida to fish fries or to car washes. And after the US government counterinsurgency attack and defeated the black movement of the 60s that Director Akile spoke of, the party focused on getting the African work class back on the agenda with bold political campaigns. The party called on the Solidarity Committee to raise resources for these major campaigns that were rebuilding the African Revolution at the time. The first food booth in San Francisco in 1978 was led by a member of the party and raised money to free Dessie Woods. Throughout the 1980s, we began doing street fairs in the San Francisco Bay Area to raise funds for African National Reparations Organization, the prison organization, the Dessie Woods campaign, and the Tribunal on Reparations for Black People in the US, and more. And you can see the giant political banners that were at the booths to really build those programs. We baked and sold giant chocolate chip cookies and traveled following the Grateful Dead throughout the US. You can see the Deadhead special there. We took cookies to all the big marches in Washington, DC. We did theater concessions, catered weddings, benefits, and concerts. This was the development of Uhuru Foods and Pies. It was coordinated by APSC for many years, and we brought it around the country throughout Northern California, the West Coast, Philadelphia, New York, West Florida. and won support for the Uhuru movement politically and brought the voice of the African working class to white communities and suburbs. We met white people who volunteered, donated, continue to get tables and tastings in their area for the pies, brought resources from the white community where we have an average of 22 times the wealth of African people. So as solidarity, we volunteer and work in these institutions and volunteer to participate in rectifying our history and the complicity in the enslavement of African people, of colonialism. And we have this responsibility, and reparations is how we have this principled relationship and unity with the African community. The chairman struggled that we take Uhuru concessions in the Holiday Pie campaign to a higher level, to be an institution of contending economic and political power. So we had raised reparations for the party to open a bakery cafe in Oakland, California in 1987. Having this restaurant and kitchen meant the party had ownership and control of the means of production, as well as the ability to raise more resources. Besides being an extremely popular institution, it was an event space and organizing center for the movement. People in the Bay Area still talk about the bakery 30 years after it was closed by mysterious fires in the apartments above it. People still ask, when are you going to open it? And now it will be in St. Louis, Missouri. Black Star Industries is led by APSP Deputy Chairwoman Ona Zanae Yeshitela, who began leading all the economic work just only about 8 years ago. She made huge qualitative leaps in transforming the party's institutions and creating and developing new ones. In the solidarity, we carry out these strategies to expand and develop the institutions. Deputy Chair began by rebranding and creating taglines that identified them as African internationalist institutions. She immediately built the promotions, prioritized the recruitment, professionalized all aspects of every institution. And I really salute Deputy Chair for all the leadership she provides to this work and to those of us in solidarity, for her bold leadership that has moved Uhuru Foods and Pies and other institutions of the Uhuru movement miles ahead in creating these dual and contending power institutions for African people to govern. So I just really want to salute Deputy Chair. She also brought graphic designer Charles Oliver into her office, and you can see evidence of his hand all over the Uhuru movement, literally. That's actually, you can't see it very well, but his hand is the one making the Africa cutout pie. He's the one who developed that, created that by cutting it out of the pie dough. So at this point today, Uhuru Foods does huge concessions at three major events in Oakland. We have weekly booths at the farmers market in Oakland and in St. Petersburg, and we carry out the Uhuru Holiday Pie campaign. I also want to salute my leadership, African People Solidarity Committee Chairwoman Penny Hess, who is here today. And the APSC Office of Reparations and Economic Development Director Kitty Riley, who's now in St. Louis, and Maureen Wagner, who's the Uhuru Foods and Pies National Director in Oakland. Chairwoman Penny Hess has led APSC for over 40 years and is really the first white person to take this stand and fought for us to organize other white people to take up our responsibility for reparations, to build the institutions and campaigns that win the stolen resources from white society. Deputy Chair also created the Uhuru NTU Volunteer Brigade Program to increase our capacity to retain and recruit volunteers. We can bring people into teams in a politicized process and win volunteers to commit to higher levels of responsibility, and it builds the African leadership in these institutions. I also wanted to recognize our team in St. Petersburg, which a lot of our team couldn't be here today, but for one, Tamara Wilson-Nine, who is, has her catering business, Tamara's Kitchen, is our head baker and mixer, who baked these delicious Uhuru pies. She has added some of her own recipes, such as the peach and the strawberry rhubarb pies that have been very popular, and she also donated the vegan lasagna that we're going to be having today. And I wanted to recognize Al Dogan, who also had to leave, who was preparing some of the caramu today as well. And he coordinates the Saturday market with all the prep, the shops, on-site, and tremendous team member. And Tommy Washington, who is our setup and breakdown and operations person on-site. Woo-hoo. I also wanted to recognize some of our great new volunteers. We have Joyce Spencer, Kaylee Pompey, who is a Gibbs student, Multicultural Advisory Committee student, and has been coming weekly. They were doing an extraordinary table at the Saturday market selling Uhuru pies, also along with Masai Van Buren, who is a 13-year-old budding entrepreneur who has a business plan to have a food truck. We also have Antonio Grant, who was going to try to be here. We have Deb Curry, who is here in the center, who is having us come this Friday to her employment, to her job, where we're going to do a Uhuru pie tasting for her architecture firm. So we really appreciate that opportunity to build Uhuru Foods and Pies. And we also have the Pinellas Park Key Club that's been continuing to work with us. And another one of our Gibbs High School Multicultural Committee members who's been working with us weekly. We have several long-term volunteers, long-time volunteers from Uhuru Solidarity, including Dorothy Eaton and Sarah Edwards, who couldn't be here today. And we have our newest volunteer, Robert Boston, who joined us yesterday. Did a tremendous job, and we're really looking forward to him being part of this team. So now I wanted to go on to explain a little bit about the Black Power Blueprint, which I wish we had more time to show some of the videos, but you can go to blackpowerblueprint.org and see them, which it's a project of Black Star Industries and the African People's Education and Defense Fund. And the 10,000 Uhuru Pies for Black Power Blueprint campaign is a really key way that we're contributing to these projects. After Mike Brown was murdered by the police in Ferguson, Missouri, the Uhuru movement began, the chairman went, and the Uhuru movement began to organize there to put organization on the ground to go beyond protest and really transform the conditions of the community. Deputy Chair went to St. Louis to identify a building for the Uhuru House and saw the potential to acquire more properties for the programs and just seized the time. She thought she would be there for a few weeks, and she has been there for 18 months, leading the successful renovation of the Uhuru House and the purchase and development of many other properties now. One thing in St. Louis, which is over 50% Black, the North Side has been really devastated by the loss of a once vibrant African economy and culture. Just rows of empty storefronts and buildings. And then you see the leisure, I'm sorry for the, it's not the right picture, somehow the pictures got messed up, but there's gourmet food and leisure in the white community at the cost of the life and livelihood of African people. And the city of St. Louis has this program to buy abandoned properties cheaply, which is actually geared to facilitate white gentrification into the, but the Black Power Blueprint began buying these properties. So you can see here in this, the brochure that we have at the front, that I want to make sure everybody gets a copy, shows the different projects of the Black Power Blueprint, which include the renovation of the Uhuru House, African Community Center, which has already become too small as an organizing center, the property next door, which two abandoned condemned buildings were demolished to become the an outdoor event space for the One Africa, One Nation marketplace and for other events. And then there's a third building, that's fine. There's a third building that's for the African Independence Workforce Program and the Uhuru Jiko Community Commercial Kitchen and Bakery Cafe, which will become the National Office and Distribution Center for Uhuru Foods and Pies. Uhuru. So I think there's more, just, that's,
I'm sorry.
Okay, that's good, no, that's good, keep going. go again. Thank you. These are some of the pictures. This is one of the properties that's going to be, it's a four apartments that can be for the African Independence Workforce Program that's being renovated right now. And all this was done through the development of a funding campaign led by APSC's Chairman Penny Hess with an outpouring of support from the community. African contractors, work crews, participated, many contractors discounted their work, companies donated supplies, hundreds of volunteers participated in these work days. You can see some of this transformation right here. In less than 6 months, the Uhuru House was transformed into a gorgeous state-of-the-art building. And then you can see the demolition of those condemned buildings to clear the lot, put up a 50-foot African flag that is just bringing tremendous pride, unity to the African community, and the first Halloween haunted night house, haunted festival that was held there by APDF just, you know, last week. The third phase will start in 2019 with the creation of the kitchen. It also has room for a garden and outdoor event space, and will be able to host the African Independence Workforce Program, which is designed to provide training and employment for Africans that are returning from the colonial prison system. So you can really see how Black Power Blueprint has really energized and united the African working class in St. Louis. We've also built a solidarity committee there to really take on unity through reparations from the white community, which sits on the pedestal of this oppression of African colonized peoples. And it just gives a vision of life for African and for all of us, for economic and political power, for a world, a different world that we want to see. So we really, the Uhuru Pie campaign has been something that we've carried out for more than 30 some years in Oakland, California, and several other cities where we've been, and probably about the past 10 years in St. Petersburg. And Uhuru Foods and Pies is launching the 10,000 Uhuru Pies for Black Power Blueprint to double the number of pies that we sold last year and to raise an extra $10,000 for Black Power Blueprint. So we really hope people will go to uhurupies.org. You can see more about the Black Power Blueprint and the history of Uhuru Foods and Pies. This is our new website, so you can go there, and then you can order and buy Uhuru Pies there. You can order online, you can call us, you can order today at the table. You can get, we're going to have tastes of all the different flavors back here. You can sell pies to your fans, family, and coworkers. Everybody loves Uhuru Pies. You can host a pie tasting like Deb is doing and others. You can sign up to sell online. We can get you signed up. You can volunteer to bake, staff the booths, or do promotions. And you can also go to Oakland, California, where we're doing an intensive from now till Thanksgiving, and also again in December, where we have 80-some tables in front of different stores, pop-ups that go in front of grocery stores and other places, and we're having a dinner on Thanksgiving Day itself. We're selling at a dozen places and having an event and dinner on reparations for Black Power Blueprint that's a tribute to African and Indigenous people. So this is a holiday tradition that's not based on parasitism, but on overturning the relationship to the African community. And this Thursday in St. Petersburg, Uhuru Solidarity Movement is sponsoring the Truth About Thanksgiving event that's gonna be 6:30 p.m. at Panera Bread. We invite everyone. And we invite you to sign up to participate. In the back, we've got next Saturday at the Saturday Morning Market. We have phone banking to our previous buyers. We have baking, assembly, boxing, labeling this Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And we also are continuing weekly through December and onward. And after that, we are also promoting Giving Tuesday, which is a online charity donation campaign that we're using to raise a goal of $20,000 for the Black Power Blueprint. And you can get more information about that at the table, so you can host a fundraiser on Facebook, get your family and friends to donate, and to watch the online Giving Tuesday webinar that's going to be Tuesday, November 27th. Thank you. Uh-huh.
Thank you, Janice Kant, for that Uhuru Pies presentation. And I don't think anybody did this at all today, but I wanted to give a huge shout out to DJ Heavy Love. Can we put our hands? I mean, his selection today has been crazy. So now I would like to bring up station manager Dia Kiese, so that he can lead the words that we will have from our Black Power 96 programmers. Uhuru.
Uhuru, everyone. I'm self-critical because we are way behind time, but we could not conclude this program without recognizing the individuals who make up Black Power 96.3 FM. And these are individuals that I work with on a personal basis. They call me, I call them, they text me, I text them. I get on their nerves, they don't get on my nerves, but. when I please call your name, please just stand so we can recognize you and the tremendous work that you do, because being a radio programmer is not easy. That includes finding your own topics. That includes finding your own music. That includes, you know, promoting your show and all of these other things that go into putting on a wonderful show. And I can say without any reserve that every show that is on Black Power 96.3 FM is an awesome show. And you need to be listening to them. So first, I want to recognize, she don't like when I call her first name, so I'm going to just say DJ Asada, who traveled here from D.C., from Washington, D.C., just to be with us today. And she hosts the First Sunday Jazz Hour that comes on every first Sunday. Next, I want to recognize the show cast of the original Florida Spiritual Lairs that consists of Mr. Larry Faison and Mr. Eddie. So y'all give them a hand. And that show comes on every... That show comes on every Thursday and Saturday from 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. And you also know the other Mr. Eddie, Mr. the Florida Blind Boy, and his show comes on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 7 to 9, and that's Good Morning Gospel. We also have No Class with your boy Iquan, and we also had our sister Cameron. She had to leave earlier, but that show comes on every Wednesday and Friday from 3 to 5. Who else we got in the house? We have DJ Heavy Love, who y'all can't see who's behind. There you go. He's been playing the music today, and he also has two shows. His first show comes on every Monday from 7 to 9, and that is The Love Train, which is slow love songs. And then on Tuesday and Thursday from 4 to 6, he has The Southern Soul Express, where he focuses on the genre of music, African music, that is known as Southern Soul. And we also have... I know that. One of the most important shows that we have on Black Power 96 will comes on every Sunday from 8 to 10 a.m., and that is hashtag Omali Taught Me, led by Chairman Omali Yeshitela. Now, that's the show. You got to tune into that. But again, just really want to give a hand clap for all of the programmers for Black Power 96.3 FM and just really express my profound appreciation. And we also have my show, My People's Keeper, which comes on every Tuesday and Thursday from 2 to 3 p.m. And while I'm up here... We do have a new show in the back that's getting ready to start on November 17th, and that is led by Brother Nkole and Sister Imani. And that is called Psychedelic. And that is beginning on November 17th, which is a Saturday at 12 p.m. So y'all make sure y'all tune in for that. And Uhuru. Thank you. Leadership, y'all. Leadership, leadership. Okay. I'm sorry. We also have another show that comes on every Sunday from 2 to 4 p.m., and that is Diasporic Music with Jalali. That's Norman Richmond. And again, that's every Sunday from 2 to 4. Oh, he's in Canada. He does his show remotely from Canada, y'all. So we doing big things, all right? And I said my show. Okay, yeah, okay, cool. All right. Oh, and we have the Black Agenda Report with Glenn Ford and Sister Nelly Bailey that comes on every Wednesday at 2 to 3, and we replay the show on Monday and Friday as well, too. So, Uhuru.
Well, thank you. All right, so thank you, Dia Kiese, for that. And we are at the part of the program where we're actually going to go outside right in front of the tower to take a group picture. But as we're doing that, I want the owner of a black Toyota Corolla, a white Subaru, and a black Mercedes to move your car because you're right in front of where we would be taking the picture at. So the three of you would have to go first. We're going to exit through this door, which is on my right and your left, travel through the hallway, through the exit door, and that's where we would take the picture. And on our way back, we would actually do a quick tour of the Black Power 96 studio so you can see where all the magic happens, as they say. And then when we come back, we will be, led by the vocalist, Sister Imani, and go into Karamu. So let's get on up and go to the right.